with another edition of the CWE webcast, and we've got quite the cast of characters here. We've got the impromptu return of Jordan Garber, who just shot his first edition of the Snake Pit, which is also going to be on this YouTube channel, and it is just as ridiculous as you think it would be. Way more ridiculous and probably inappropriate. And at the end of the line, we've got from TSN 1290, we've got Hustler on the program.
Danny, thanks. You know, I came for the Zubaz and stayed for the podcast.
I like it. this might be the first time some people see your face at home, because they're definitely familiar with the voice as they drive home from work, but they now get an opportunity to see what that pretty face looks like. So if they see Santa Lucia's, they know to pass a drink along to.
Well, this was very convenient, being a resident of this neighborhood, to just pop down, hang out, talk a little wrestling with you guys, and have a good time. Big fan of your work, I will say this, just to start this off. I've known you for a while, but outside
now.
Of the ring. But now seeing what you've been able to do, the career you're charting out, and all the shit that you're involved in, it's great to be here.
Yeah, well, truthfully, before we start talking the meat and potatoes of the stuff, I have to give you a lot of credit back, because it was, I think, a big part of CWE growing over the last couple of years was when we first started to get on TSN 1290 and do some of those interviews. I bumped into you, I was out with a mutual friend of ours, I ran into you on Corden, and you kind of hooked us up with getting some of our stars on the radio. And from there, we always saw growth. Every time we got one of our big stars on TSN 1290, the attendance grew a little bit bigger.
You know what, I will say this, and I'm glad that worked out well, because I will say this, I've been a wrestling fan my whole life. Maybe not as into it as some of the people that are really in, but you know, I do follow the WWE, and knowing some of the guys that are in the independent wrestling scene, frankly, they've been some of my favorite interviews we've ever done. And you know, being able to kind of follow what you're trying to create here in the PEG and the growing of CWE has been awesome, and it's great to be a part of it. We've had a heck of a great time when we've come out to some of the events you guys have put on, and things seem to be going in a great direction, so when you called, I'm like, I'm down.
Some of your own staff have performed in professional wrestling matches.
I'll be honest, the Westwood, we brought a crew out, and that was the big, there was a 50-man
Rumble.
Oh,
that was the Rumble, yeah.
Yeah. Right, and Westy and Danny were in a tag team match, and when his opponent, his name escapes me, I don't think it was the Outlaw Adam Knight.
The Mecca Shane Madison.
Yes, that's right. Oh, how can I forget the Mecca? It was put in a very vulnerable position, and Westy went in trying to kick a 55-yarder. Well, we did name his finishing move that night the Convert, because nobody kicked the Convert better than Westy. But that was an amazing show. Our boy Mike Young from the weigh-in was also involved in that. And, man, we had such a blast. And I got to tell you, it's very impressive as to what you guys are doing and how many people are supporting it. Never mind all the guys that are involved in it. That was a great show. Looking forward to Friday night and the rest of.
So, what are the chances we get you in the Rumble this year?
Well, you know, I never thought about it, but put on camera, that certainly would be something. I have often fancied myself as either a manager type or something, so I will certainly leave the door open to an appearance in a some sort of CWE event.
We'll take care of you in there.
Yeah, exactly. Well, my boys.
Well, now that we've gotten Westwood and Mike Young in the ring, maybe we can get them together as a TSN tag team, and you could be the mouthpiece for it.
TSN tag team,
that would
be great. I will... It'll spit some green mist in someone's
face. So you said you've been a wrestling fan your whole life, not to date you or age you. When was that? When did you start watching professional wrestling?
I mean, really sort of the 80s. I mean, you know, when you're a kid, you're kind of seeing, I mean, it was really big at that time. You know, obviously Hulkamania, Bret the Hitman Hart was massive. And,
was that kind of your first introduction? Was like the WWF, or did you see some AWA stuff here in Winnipeg?
When I was very young, I did see AWA. My first ever wrestling match was a cage match. Match at the Winnipeg Arena. Rick Martel was in it. He was the
Travis was a bit of a crush on Rick.
I believe he may have been the champion at the time. Again, I was very, very young.
Something like 1985.
Something like that. And I do recall going to, geez, I can't believe I remember this date, but early November 1987.
Wow.
Was Hulk Hogan versus Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff at the arena. And yeah, man, you know, those are the things, you know, when you're a kid, you know, always remember.
Oh, yeah.
I've seen a million hockey games. I will never forget Hulk Hogan and Mr. Wonderful.
Absolutely, yeah.
And you know, from that, I mean, you know, you've seen it kind of go up and down, but you know, in the 90s when it was huge, you know, it was right in that, you know, teenage, young adult phase. And it was so good. It never really left me. I mean, I know, I follow it as much from an outside perspective, really, as watching every segment and whatnot goes on television. And it has been fascinating to see just the business, what's happened since, you know, WCW crumbled and it got on. I mean, I've got the WWE Network, and to be honest with you, my favorite things to watch are like the stories of the Monday Night Wars, because the business is fascinating, and particularly when you get to meet guys like yourselves that are involved in it behind the scenes, but really that are putting so much into it. And, you know, and frankly, for, you know, some of the guys that, you know, we've brought on the show and we've had a chance to meet, the stories they have from, I mean, listen, those Tony Candelo stories, I could listen to those all day long. When you hear those, you learn how much sacrifice really goes into it. So I got a ton of respect for everyone that does what you guys do. And it makes actually watching the big show that much more enjoying, because you know these guys, for the most part, didn't just fall out of nowhere. They had, and we're seeing that a lot in WWE right now.
Yeah, that's the crazy thing about wrestling, as entertaining and captivating as it is. I've said this time and time again, if you just followed behind the scenes and threw that on TV, it would blow anything out of the water on television.
Like, that's the real reality.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, just like the characters and the egos and the politics and professional wrestling, and it's a whole other world, and it surprises me that it's never really been captured. You'll see, you know, documentary crews here and there follow it around and do it. You get a little bit of a glimpse into it when they do these stories, you know, on the wars and stuff like that.
But actually, like, they're toning it down for that, because
if you actually just had a camera crew on the road day to day, like, man, dealing with the bullshit, like, it'd be on another
plane. Well, and your Twitter feed is a perfect example of that. I mean, I always get a kick out of your tweets when you're, you know, either doing something ridiculous, you know, in the gym, or driving 7 hours to some small spot. I'm not going to be dismissive, but literally, I mean, you guys grind, and no matter what business you're in, I got a ton of respect for guys that put so much into something without any guarantee of anything happening, because you really love what you're doing.
Yep.
I'm lucky. I love what I'm doing, and, you know, I don't have to drive the Moose Jaw to do the show.
So you talked about, you know, the 80s, that's kind of when WWF started to come into Winnipeg. You talked about the 90s. Did you kind of stay on the wrestling train when it kind of dipped in the 90s? And then after the Attitude Era, did you stay kind of loosely connected?
I would say loosely connected is probably a good way of putting it. I mean, I would always pay attention, you know, when I'm flipking around on Raw. But, you know, being and doing sports for a living, I mean, you know, Monday Night Football goes up against Monday Night Raw. It's been more in the last few years where I've just made a point, I'm just going to have it PVR'd. If I'm up late at night on Monday, I'll watch it, or I'll catch up with it. You know, it's probably an easier way to watch a 3-hour show, as we all know. I mean, that can go on. But, I have been on top of it, not to a heavy extent, but I have to admit, like, the last few years, it's between the rise of wrestling, really, at a local level. Like, a lot of stuff has to do with what you guys are doing. I just find myself exposed to it more. And again, you know, the WWE knows how to entertain. So there's always some good and bad, and it's worth watching.
As a viewer, I'm curious to your, you know, your thoughts on why you dropped off and what brought you back into wrestling over the years. Because, you know, as being in the business, I was always just connected to wrestling.
Yeah.
That was my passion. But your story is very similar to so many people that were wrestling fans over the years and still are, where they were really big fans during, like, the peak periods, but then there's something that kind of lost them along the way. What was it for you that kind of been like, I'm going to take a break from this? Was it the presentation, the wrestling?
You know what? I think everyone's different. And, you know, if we're talking about just one person, obviously there's all sorts of things that are happening in their life that, you know, may really have nothing to do with the product, but has, you know, an effect on what the numbers are. There are particular personalities that are must-see TV, and, you know, you think of Stone Cold Steve Austin and The Rock, and, you know, and Mick Foley, probably my all-time favorite, just what he was able to do. I mean, he did some of the craziest stuff in the world physically that, like, sometimes, like, I'm not a guy that's really into that, like, literally, like, I can barely even watch that Hell in a Cell thing when he's going off. And we saw a lot of that going to WrestleMania, and Psycho Shane was about to go in with The Undertaker. But I love the comedy part of wrestling has always been by far my favorite part.
When wrestling kind of took its most recent dip in popularity around 2002, 2003 kind of thing, I noticed like boxing almost at the same time took a huge decrease in interest. Do you think that's because streaming media and things like that were beginning to take off and there were so many more entertainment options out there? Or do you think that's just sheer coincidence?
It's a really interesting question. I mean, the boxing industry itself has been so screwed up for so long that, you know, you can have a Mike Tyson, you can have a De La Hoya, you can have a star, you know, and, you know, even Mayweather is repulsive as a personality that he is. You know, he's great at what he does.
Oh, absolutely.
You don't want to watch it. But overall, that entire business has been run by crooks. I mean, you talk to all the greats from, you know, 10 years ago and earlier and how they've been taken. I mean, the Don King stories, I mean, I don't need to tell you guys. And, you know, it's sort of, you almost feel bad supporting it at times. Wrestling is different in a way, but, you know, to your question, it's hard to, and I'm not a hardcore UFC guy at all. I mean, like, I follow it, and I mean, my favorite UFC guy ever was Brock Lesnar.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh my God, Brock Lesnar in the UFC, doubt.
Who's
going to want
to fight that guy? No
like,
way.
I am all in on that. But that has been, I mean, if you're looking at the last 15 years of combat sports and where wrestling fits into the framework of UFC, I think, might have the biggest thing. And you know what? Mm-hmm. Because Dana White has taken a legitimate sport, got rules for it, you know, has some good backing on it. But that dude is Vince Jr.
Oh, yeah,
absolutely. He's taken the elements of people's personalities. and you can even see by people's win-loss records.
When they push, the bigger stars, the people that can...
Oh yeah, and it's
set
time,
a microphone.
It's set time and time again. Win-loss records do not guarantee title shots in the UFC. It's look at Conor McGregor, perfect example. Yes, he hadn't lost a UFC fight going into the interim title match and the title match with Jose Aldo, but Frankie Edgar and guys, Max Holloway, guys like that, were coming off way long. They're in the same weight division, and they're coming off more wins off more credible opponents, but they're dry.
Hey,
they're
those
dry.
Guys, and this is no. You know, not to diminish what McGregor is capable of in the octagon, because I'm not someone to judge. But those guys are athletes and great at what they do. But so much of the fight game, no matter what discipline you're in, is being able to sell the fight.
Self-promotion, yes.
And Dana White, wrestling gets that. Dana White certainly gets that. And boxing, unfortunately, that's a big reason why it's sort of been left in the dust. It didn't connect with that idea earlier, and the few that have done it do it really well and are huge.
Even to a further extent, if you look at other legitimate sports, hockey, football, the good player that's a little controversial with his interview time is always going to get more press and sell more merch than the guy that's scoring touchdowns, that's a little bit more quiet, reserved, and isn't that much, you know, that interesting to listen to in the press conference afterwards.
Listen,
it's that sports is entertainment. They use sports entertainment for wrestling, but it's sports entertainment for everything now. It's not about the sport anymore. It's about the spectacle. It's about the event. And that goes down to the most pure sports in the world.
Oh, look at Dennis Rodman. He was good. He was pretty good. He was on a great team for a good majority of his career. But he wasn't the best player out there. But he was definitely one of the most captivating, if not the most captivating.
He was a freak show.
Yeah, he was a freak show.
I mean,
he
showed up in a wedding dress.
But
he was the best defensive player in the league, and he was a champion.
Exactly. He's one of the best rebounders out there. And Jordan, one of the, if not the greatest basketball players of all time, but he was one of the driest interviews of major sports. You know, he's bland.
Killer on the court, and otherwise just didn't want to piss anybody off. He wanted to sell his shoes, get
make some Hanes commercials. Exactly.
Well, I mean, and from the black community, that was a huge criticism of Jordan from, you know, the small percentage that didn't really idolize him, was that he had such an opportunity to make a difference for the people that really were supporting him. And, you know, as a white guy, it's hard to say, oh, you should do this or do that. But, I mean, I've heard that from a ton of people that said, you know, what a missed opportunity to really, I mean, that guy. And Tiger Woods is the same way. I mean, my God, Tiger Woods more than anyone. I mean, mixed race, you know, a legendary, I mean, one is in a lifetime golfer that changed a sport. never really took a stance, and I'm not here to tell you you have to do it. I mean, like, I'm in the media. Like, I don't make my political views.
He was a pretty good influence on me with all the women he was sleeping with.
Yeah,
that came during the decline of the play.
Never feel guilty about a rendezvous in the Denny's parking lot.
There's a theory I have with Tiger Woods' large amount of women that he sleep with, and his, you know, his wife being upset about it and everything. See, Tiger Woods has, you know, he's one of the most well-known sports celebrities of his time, so he has hundreds of thousands of women throwing themselves at him, if not millions of women willing to sleep with
him. And Travis Cole.
So if he sleeps with seven or eight of them, that's like 0.001%. So that's, you round that
he's
off.
He's turning down.
You're 0.001%. You round that off, that's 0%. He didn't even do it. You know, if you really do your math, he's innocent.
Completely off topic, but just in life in general.
Yeah, good calculation.
The way I look at it, if you are a woman marrying a major sports star or entertainer, you've got to be accepting that that's going to happen.
Oh yeah,
you can't sit there and be like,
we actually had.
Oh, really?
Hang on. If he ever gets married, I'm playing this at the reception.
We actually had that quote at the reception.
Had a pretty big debate. This kind of spans generations, and you might be able to chime in on this. Over who is the bigger Canadian icon between Wayne Gretzky and Justin Bieber? And then so we're bringing up the facts and the stats and the figures. And I said, well, who slept with more girls? And they're like, oh, Bieber. Gretzky was married. I go, Gretzky played 20 years, 40 road games a year. That's 800 women. That's 800 women. That alone is 800 women. Never mind at home. Never mind in the summer. Never mind wherever else. You know, don't worry about the chick from the Van Halen video. Like, yeah, that's his wife. Sure, that's
quite the question.
You know, I'm like, but that's 800 right there. 800 road games.
What about Bret Hart in that argument? Because he was a known womanizer who was
taking
up on the road pretty good, and he's
I think a lot of Bret Hart's time was spent on repeat business. Like he was Sonny a lot and talking to I don't want to you know put anyone on the spot in case this you know gets in the wrong hands, but I was, you know, traveling on one of our tours with somebody from that era, and they said what the boys would do is they'd have an address book, and it would just say Winnipeg, and there'd be a phone number next to it, and so they'd go back to the same booking, they'd go back to the same girl in each city, so
but there'd never be a name, so they couldn't
no,
get, like,
except
their wife ever came across the book.
Well, there was one guy who kept names. I don't want to, you know, like...
Shout out to DeMarco Murray. Yeah. Put your name in her phone as spray tan.
Yeah. There was one guy who kept names, and he was sending postcards back and forth with these girls he was banging on the road. His wife caught wind of it, and shit hit the fan.
Yeah.
So he had to, you know, completely...
Well, back then, it had to be easy. Like,
yeah.
There's no social media, there's no Facebook,
yeah.
There's no text messaging.
And there's a guy from that era, same guy that I was traveling with a couple years ago, and, you know, we spent 4 or 5 days together and everything, and he said, and so, you know, as we're getting near the end of the tour, he gave me a cell number, and he's like, yeah, shoot me a text, we'll chat, whatever. I go, you don't have social media? He's like, no, I can't, because I've been married since 1978. He goes, and if I had a Facebook, he's like, and my kids are on there who are adults now, if I had a Facebook, there'd be chicks going on there like, hey, I fucked him before. He's like, ruined me 20 years ago.
I think that comes down to, like, if you're dating an athlete or an entertainer that's, you know, making tons of money, people are throwing themselves at you, and he's gone all the time, just ask him to be safe about it. Do your thing at home and enjoy the money he's sending back.
But that's not really why people, I think, get into these apparently lifetime relationships. That
absolutely.
Is weird. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's one of those things, but you're right. I mean, today's day and age, it's different. And listen, let's just look at the numbers. I mean, for regular people that are not in that situation, what's the divorce rate? Probably over 50%, right?
Easily, yeah.
Yeah,
easily.
Something like that.
Oh, yeah.
So that's just for average dudes or couples.
Oh yeah, plumbers,
gardeners,
guys.
That
7-11.
Much money, opportunity, everything. I mean, like, I get what you're saying, but it's pretty tough to say. Listen, just so you know, we're doing this, but I'm a free agent on the road.
I guess it's a Steel Panther song.
I mean, yeah, community property.
Community property, yeah.
I think that makes sense. But to get back on track to wrestling, and you asked about the decline and if that had something to do with it. I think a big part of it too is you talk about, you know, more entertainment options. That's definitely prevalent now.
Yeah.
But if you look back, they talk about the, I think it was like the Hogan-Andre match in the 80s, drew that record like 11.3
That was the Silverdome, right?
Yeah, it was
a rematch on NBC. It did like 11
where Andre actually won the title.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
It was like the highest rating wrestling show ever, and I would never be duplicated. If you go back to 1988 or 87 or whatever, there was like, what, 12 channels?
Yeah, there's
so
watch.
One of 12 channels you're going to watch that night.
And, if you look at the all-time most watched episodes of television, in the top 20 there's like 11 episodes of Beverly Hillbillies in there, because that's when they had three channels, so everyone that had television, what else are you doing?
There's no way to measure
that. Well, technology, I mean, you guys do a very good job of it. I mean, utilizing Facebook and all these things where you don't need to have a massive budget to be able to do what you love, put on a product, and promote it to your core and have it grow. Mm-hmm. I mean, that simply was not an option back in the day.
You're putting VHS tapes in the mail.
And let's face it, you know, having seen your shows, and this is, you know, I'm not greasing you guys on this. Having seen your shows, the stuff that you're doing right now is right up there with, you know, we were talking about watching old AWA, like on, you know, Channel 12. We watched it just because it was pro wrestling, and it was on. Now there is the ability to, you know, you don't have to have a TV deal. And if you don't, frankly, there's a million TV stations. We talk about that Raw number. Yeah, the number might be down, but the more I think about it, the amount of time I see wrestling information or stuff on pro wrestling in the WWE right now, never mind indies, just for my Twitter feed or things like that, is, I mean, a million times more than it had ever been before. So, you know, the numbers down, is that how we judge pro wrestling right now? I don't think so.
I want to leave it at that because we do have to take our first commercial break. But when we do come back, I want to touch base on that because Raw had the lowest rating it's had in ages last night going up against Monday Night Football. So let's take a break and let's jump in and kind of dissect the numbers and why that might be. Because I think you're onto something. Same way you become anything else. You have to go to school and work really, really, really hard.
Instead, tears stream down his face.
I'm a personal trainer, so I help people get in shape and in the gym.
Back, the garbage snake is about three times the size and now Asian.
it's not the garbage
snake really is like a anaconda or something. He's grown in size. He's a lot bigger now.
Billion.
Garbage Snake is out. Garbage Man Rob has joined us for the rest of the program. Before we took commercial break, we're talking about the ratings. And I misinterpreted that. It was the lowest since Monday Night Football. And it's coming right over WrestleMania season where things are usually a little bit hot.
Well, it's a big deal when they're going up against Monday Night Football, right? Because, yeah. I mean, Monday Night Football is just a juggernaut of its own.
Yeah.
And even during that time, you know, you're going to lose a million viewers to it. But I guess this one was concerning because...
This is lowest ever.
This is
lowest
not
ever that wasn't
football.
Against football. Yeah.
Excluding.
So... There's been many arguments about this in the last year because, I had a long talk with the Road Dogg the last time I did WWE TVs, and he's been very vocal about that on social media as well, because people are like, oh, the ratings are down, the product needs to be changed. But he'll talk about how the stock is the highest it's ever been. WrestleMania was the highest growing wrestling event in the history of wrestling.
Yeah.
So the business isn't hurting. Like, they're making money. So how much stock is now put into what the rating is and how low it is? Because for someone like myself who doesn't have cable, in my newsfeed, WWE posts pretty much every major clip in his own individual video now, so I don't need to sit through 3 hours of Raw. I can scroll and be like, oh, cool, this happened.
You're
that
in the
happened.
Business.
Yeah.
You have all people. Like, you're more than any average dude.
Yeah.
Tied
and I just got that cool little gimmick box that I can download.
The Android box.
The Android box.
And,
so,
and yeah, streaming, you know, not that I'm condoning illegal piracy here or anything, but you know, you get a Twitter account.
You'll see it in 10 minutes.
Yeah,
exactly.
Like,
yeah,
and like, we watched some of Raw, we started watching Raw at the house, and he just threw it up on Daily Motion. So people are watching still, but through various mediums.
Yeah, and it's not a tangible number that you can put on your amount of viewers, because it's not just coming from one source anymore. It's coming from multiple sources, and that's just it. It's like you said, some people kind of cherry pick what they want to watch. They're still getting eyes on their product, and it's still getting...
The only thing that might be alarming is they might not have as much negotiation power to get as much money out of the TV station for their deal if their ratings aren't as high. But how? What are the ratings compared to...
That's why they started their own network.
Then again, though, you have to remember, like, there was a big thing about that, like a big, big huff about that where people were talking about filing lawsuits and stuff because...
Why are you feeling your leg up while you do this? You're getting a little excited. These ratings.
I was nonchalantly scratching anyways. Thanks for snooching me off.
So it's video, they can see you.
Yeah, thanks. It's no scalper. Anyway. What was my point? Jeez, I don't think
you had fired up. Yeah, I think you're
trampling, man. No, I don't think that you can put too much stock into this because there's so many different ways that people are watching things now. TV as a whole is way down. It's record lows.
Oh, cable television.
The only thing that's drawing big numbers is live sports.
Yeah.
And that's why Raw, because people think of it still as a live sport.
Sure.
Even though, as we all know, you can throw on your PVR and go back and enjoy Raw the next day.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to, if I PVR a Jet game, I mean, I know who won the game
results.
Or not.
Yeah.
You know, it's totally not the
Can
same.
Can they account for PBR like in their ratings? Do they have a thing for that yet?
Yes,
okay.
But advertisers only care about the first 3 days that you watch it. There's live next day, live 3 days,
but
and then live 7 days.
Advertisers can't care about those PBR numbers, because that's what people are PBRing and fast-forwarding through,
they
right?
They generally care about they care a little bit about the first 3 days.
Okay.
Like, the network themselves for sure will care about whatever the number is that they can give to their sponsors.
Yes.
But, I mean, if you're the WWE, I mean, you want to talk a tangible number, it's asses in seats at shows.
Yeah.
And as far as I know, WrestleMania, as you guys just mentioned, threw six figures into Jerry World.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, like, you tell me, like, if when the WWE comes to Winnipeg, you know, if they're doing a big crowd, I mean, that I think is the best way to know whether, because, I mean, this is not just like, oh, I'm going to watch it at some point. This is people parting with their money, and it's the same thing doing what you guys do.
But as a publicly traded company, like that Raw deal, like the reason they're doing 3 hours is because they're getting paid a lot of money to do three instead of two.
Yeah.
Like, that's a heavy source of income. So if that's going to, hurt the bottom line, it's got to be something.
How long has it been a three-hour show, though? That was during the Nitro days,
like,
right?
And it's rough to watch 3 hours. They just started doing that a year or two ago.
Yeah. It's been almost 3 years now, actually.
Yeah.
But that was actually, I just remember the point I made was when you guys were talking about leveraging the network for money, people were talking about suing them because, and I don't remember the story fully, but the general idea was
WWE promised their stockholders allegedly that they were going to double or triple or whatever their they were going to double or triple their TV rights thing.
That's happened right now. I mean, think of the Rogers deal, and again, I mean, all things say I work for Bell, like the competitor, and
right.
Rogers got it, but they paid $5.2 billion for the NHL deal.
Yeah, yeah,
huge
For 12 years, and then when they went and sold, you know, their sponsorships, they guaranteed a certain level of viewership that wasn't met.
Yeah.
Well, and then it didn't happen again. So, I mean, they are being a huge company, right? They're making good, and a bunch of inventory from other things is now going to take care of other customers that were in on the hockey. So, it, I mean, that certainly is a reality if that's what they were doing. But, I mean, that's really from WWE to who they're selling. I mean, I don't even know.
And the thing was, they did increase their TV rights quite a bit, actually. Like, they increased it by 50%. So if, say, I have no idea what the number is, but say it was $100 million per whatever, they got an extra $50 million. You know what I mean? Like, they increased it by 50%.
Well, here's
so
the thing.
They were shopping.
We think of this,
we
think of this so much just from our, you know, like we're here in Winnipeg, or, you know, this is on, you know, it's on in Canada, and it's the USA number, whatever it is on. This is a worldwide business.
Yeah.
I mean, like, we're talking about North American numbers. I mean, look at what happens when they go overseas. Look what happens when they send people to, like, other parts of the world.
They're doing their two-week Europe tour right now.
You talk about Wayne Gretzky. We joked around, like, if you took Wayne Gretzky and Hulk Hogan and stuffed them in
India,
10 random countries around the world, I'll tell you, I mean, there might be one or two, like, in Finland, they'll know Wayne Gretzky.
Recognize it from their culture.
That's what it comes down to, like, being a promoter, no matter what town I run, there'll be at least one person I'll ask every night, oh, how many people were there? And I truthfully never have counted the attendance at one of my events. I just count the money afterwards. Because it doesn't matter. If there's 600 people in the building and 400 of them didn't pay, I didn't have 600 people in the building, right? So it comes down to the numbers. So if people are paying and WWE's making money, that's what matters. But with that being said, we talked about, like, the record number low. If they take those numbers and other shows that are on at the same time and compare it to those time slot 10 years ago, are those record lows as well?
Cable television as a whole is experiencing record lows. You know, you even look at, like, and I know you can argue, like, oh, this show has declined, that show has declined. You have to look at shows that have spent 10, 15 years, but say, like, Saturday Night Live, for example, but you're still seeing people putting up clips, like, you know, when you get your Timberlakes or someone like that hosts the show, when it's a kind of a bigger deal.
People will see the clip, but they're not watching the show.
Exactly.
And that's why, and this goes back to why Rogers threw $5.2 billion down to get NHL hockey, is because over the course of the last, and it's brief, I mean, we're talking 3-4 years.
Yeah.
The top-rated shows on television have gone like this, and the one thing that advertisers can count on people watching in real time is live sports.
That's why I still have cable. I get my Sunday ticket.
What are you gonna do? You're not gonna see the Chiefs kick the Raiders' ass or
whatever. But I think, like, a lot of the entertainment industry is catching on to that because they all will upload their show now online or clips, and it's polluted with advertising now, where it wasn't like that 5 years ago. There might be a little bit of advertising, but now there's a lot. You have to watch a minute commercial before each clip starts. Something pops up in between.
You don't want to pay for it? You got to do it.
Because there's a lot.
And you don't know what the cost of putting on a wrestling show is.
Well, they got their ghost.
Imagine doing it next level with everything that goes into it.
Yeah.
I mean, you need to really maximize any revenue opportunity you have.
Said,
because your number one has been kind of getting chipped away just by technology more than anything.
Yep.
And something else that I've talked about as well, I think wrestling has changed in the sense that the product's still good. Like, the wrestling's great. It's probably, like, the in-ring stuff's the best it's been in ages.
Without question.
But with there being so many entertainment options now, social media consuming people's lives, literally the point where you can be in any public place and everyone is on their phone, on social media, it's tough to get people to commit on a weekly basis to any television program.
Yep.
So I think wrestling, people like it, but they may not commit their life to it every week like we used to in the 90s or in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's kind of like the circus coming to town now. It's like, oh, cool, WWE's coming to the MTS Center. I love wrestling. I'm going to go watch it. But I'm not going to watch it every Monday night to see what's going on.
Sure. Listen, it's a sports and entertainment. But listen, you show me one show or sport that goes 12 months a year around the clock. There isn't anything. I mean, hockey, listen.
So popular.
The guests just finished the show. I mean, I've been working every game all season long. I would have loved to have the team in the playoffs right now. But it was done. Okay, great. Well, I got weekends back. And
yeah.
And now, as much as I'm, like, watching the games, you know, I'm not as locked into it. I mean, I'm doing as much as work. If I was, I'd be like, oh, man, let's be good. I'm going to get away. I'll be outside. And then there's football season. It doesn't make me like hockey any less. But, I mean, there's a defined time for this. That's wrestling. And, you know, you have the big WrestleMania season, and everything's kind of ramped up to it.
Yeah.
And then it's natural. I mean, it is. I can't imagine what it's like, and the pressure on those guys to put that product on 52 weeks a year with everything that goes into it. And as much as I love what's going on in the ring, that actually fascinates me the most about the business, because that ain't easy.
Well, that's why WrestleMania does so well. I think it's like the go-to event now for wrestling fans. It's like, I still like wrestling. I'm not going to follow it all the time, but I'll go to WrestleMania. And if you want to factor in other things as well, like with the internet and technology now, all wrestling is so accessible you can watch wrestling anywhere in the world with any wrestler in the world at any time. You can simply log on to YouTube or any company's website.
Well, wrestling how else could a guy like AJ Styles come into the WWE and immediately be legit and a star?
Yeah.
Because
10 years ago that would have happened.
80% of the people follow wrestling, they're wrestling fans, so they've been on, you know, they know about what a guy like that has done, and they don't need to spend 6 months saying, this guy's good, and I know his name, he comes in, has a couple great matches, all of a sudden,
and I think by embracing that, they've kind of gotten back to where they haven't been in a long time since the existence of WCW, where a guy can come in from outside this company and immediately be plugged into a semi-main event or main event spot. There has been years and years, and let's face it, TNA guys, you're not plugging James Storm or Eric Young into a fucking main event spot, you know, be them the champs, whatever kind of thing. You're not plugging, even when guys came back over, like Christian and stuff, it's not as big as in the 90s when, like, holy fuck, you know, Kevin Nash and Scott Hall showed up on WCW. Hey, that fucking, the giant Paul White is coming to WWE or Jericho or whoever, right? It's not, there's not interchangeable main event talent for the longest time, and now it's starting to be where these Bullet Club guys and these guys that are just these independent internet, you know, sensations.
They got
that that got as big because of the accessibility due to the streaming media and technology, are able to do that now. They're able to come in and create this huge buzz, like, holy fuck, AJ Styles is in a WWE ring. Let's put him
I was really blown away by the reaction he got. Like, I knew deep down, like, he'd be over in Chicago, New York, Philly, you know, the smart LA, markets.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's been over everywhere.
Oh,
and that's where it really, like, clicked with me that the internet is such a strong presence for wrestling now that you can be established elsewhere and be a guy wrestling in Japan and come over and make it. And then it really was solidified when the Bullet Club debuted with Carl Anderson and Doc Gallows, and they got a super big reaction.
Insane.
They weren't even on TNA TV, they were on Japanese TV.
Yeah.
So it's crazy that you can be completely off the radar in North America and still have that kind of impact.
I was fascinated when we had Kenny Omega come on my show that you guys hooked up. We talked about what he was doing. I mean, just having a conversation with him out of, you know, not in his wrestler persona, but talking about his life and about how big they are in Japan and what they do, and then, you know, throwing that out, the amount of feedback we had on Twitter just from people that, oh, that's his name, I mean, it was amazing. And that is brand new to, I mean, that was not happening maybe 5, certainly not 10 years ago. And I think we're seeing it now in what WWE is doing with their product post-WrestleMania, with bringing in a bunch of new guys, knowing that, you know, this actually can help the business as opposed to being a burden and have to prove these guys, you know, are someone you want to want.
And I think evidence to them embracing that is forever, for the last 10, 15 years, they don't allow guys, when they bring them into the company, no matter where they're from, WWE assigns them a new name because this is the name you're going to get famous under and we're going to own that name. They don't do that with these guys. AJ Styles is AJ Styles. Samoa Joe is Samoa Joe.
Yeah.
Carl Anderson's Carl. Like, these guys are who they were on the independent scene because they know, like, hey, we want to let people know that these guys that they know and love are
now
on our
roster. It makes no sense for them
roster.
To do that now, because really, WWE is the king of the hill.
They
own the business. So before, it was like, oh, we don't want to give credo to, you know, WCW or whatever it was.
Yeah.
I think they were sort of more fearful or territorial. Now they're like, listen, if we're paying this guy anyways, if we can come in, use his real name, and that helps us more, why wouldn't we
do especially
it?
With the network, they're eventually going to own everyone's footage from somewhere in the world, so it'll be a benefit to them to have an AJ Styles. He'll eventually own TNA's tape collection, and they'll throw it on the network, and you go back and watch him on his journey to WWE. So it's really, and I think that's why the independent scene, I was crazy, one of those memories came up on my Facebook and I was talking about it 2 years ago, how the business was just starting to explode, and we were onto something, because like that's really, I was on the road full-time that year.
That was roughly at 30.
Yeah, I was on the road a lot that year, like all over North America, different parts of the country, and houses were great. Like everywhere I went, didn't matter if it was Minnesota,
Oregon,
Portland, Newfoundland, it was growing everywhere, and I was like, it felt like a really cool feeling. You kind of feel it happening, like right before you. And now, 2 years later, it's exploded. Where everywhere you go for an independent show, it's packed.
Yeah.
Regardless if there's a big headliner on it or not, like people are excited for wrestling.
Just, yeah.
And it's been talked about how the internet killed business and stuff like that. I think now, 10 years later, it's helping the business because
yes.
it's now
absolutely
it's now getting word out there.
And from, and I mean, I say this from, I mean, you know what the bills are and whatnot better than me, but. From the outside looking in, independent wrestling has never been more legit and more real. I mean, literally, some of the independent wrestling like 15, 20 years ago was, I mean, you'd see it and it would be like, geez, I mean, they weren't doing anything, like they weren't really athletes. It was, it was taking an A product of what you looked and it was just, you know. Yeah, exactly. I mean, I don't want to say it because, I mean, you know, guys are sort of into it. I mean, I remember going to elementary school, and one of my friend's dads was a masked wrestler back, like, in the old days. I think it was, like, he was a pizza guy or something like that.
Here in Winnipeg.
Here in Winnipeg. And we found out about this, and it was, like, you know, one of those complete paradigm shifts because, you know, you're still 7, 8 years old, and really into wrestling.
Do you recall what his
But all of a sudden, one of your old friends, his name was Dr. Good. His name was Dr. Good, and we're like, Trev's dad is Dr. Good? I mean, it was just completely mind-blowing.
Yeah.
But this was, it was kind of more fun, and the wrestling was way different. I mean, we've gone through some eras, and, this was not the hardcore stuff. And some of that stuff, I mean...
So did you ever go to the local shows as a kid?
Honestly, I went to one when I was really young, but it wasn't, I mean, it doesn't stick out in my head. It was at one of the community centers. I would have been 12 or 13 years old. And
Dr. Good didn't deliver the goods.
And it was, I don't even know if I saw him, but this is the thing. That was sometimes on TV.
Oh, wow.
Like they
that must
had,
Candelo.
They
yeah,
had a song.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, definitely. This is Tony's thing back in the day. And, it was a very, very different time, and you're young. But again, so you're seeing a little bit of that, and then you're seeing Hulk Hogan against Paul Orndorff.
Yeah.
Like it didn't even seem like the same thing. Really.
Before we get to the greatest five topics here and some sports stuff, you mentioned Tony earlier and listened to his stories. Have you ever had him on 1290?
I'm not sure whether you did it on 1290. We have definitely spoke before. I mean we've
I don't
been
think you could put him online.
Yeah, I don't think you could put him online.
Yeah,
you need a tape delay on that. But you
we stuck
into
pimping whatever the next thing
the Richard Pryor, Andrew Dice Clay tape delay with the finger on the button.
Heavy delay.
Dave Petro did say when he did his interview with us that in the 80s, that's what kind of killed the local business. It was like the local guys were kind of just everyday dudes living in Winnipeg, and then WWF expanded or exploded on TV with Hulk Hogan, Paul Orndorff, and all of a sudden the local guys weren't so impressive. And he said,
the difference from the products was there was such a huge gap.
He said bodybuilding killed the business.
It was your dad hopping off the couch and hopping in a ring as opposed to, your Hogan's.
Well, that's a credit to what you guys are doing right now because, I mean, honestly, like I brought a couple dudes when you guys were doing the big thing at Holy Cross, and we were kind of fired up to go see it because we knew some of the guys in it.
Yeah,
I was totally unprepared for the quality, and I mean, I watched quite a bit of wrestling, for the quality of stuff that you guys were doing. And I mean, there were some of the guys that you had brought in that were really good. Obviously, to have Westy in a match like that with guys that. It wasn't a freak show. It was good. And he's a great athlete. Like, he doesn't look out of place in that
sort
of thing.
He's built like a freak.
Absolutely. I don't know, man.
I'm impressed with the guy.
But the whole thing was just, and this was not me saying it to the other guys. We left afterwards. We were having a couple of beers afterwards. And the guys were like, I cannot believe how awesome that was. And I mean, the Rumble was hilarious, too. And
sure,
like,
yeah.
In the comedic side.
Yeah, we had the kind of the old
You had some hilarious entries into that. But the end of it, it all was... It was a really top-notch show, and everyone that we were with was their eyes were really open to the level of competition and just the product that you guys are doing. And I'm sure, I don't see a lot of the other indies, but I mean, you see the way it's growing in a lot of other places, and I'm sure that's good for you because, I mean, the more the quality of everything happens, the more people are into it.
It's crazy how easy you can reach wrestling fans now with a simple hashtag on Twitter or Instagram.
Like,
Well, like, when we're on, like, when we're on tour, we're always hashtagging the towns we're going to or the towns we're in, and we will find people. People will find us that way. Oh, there's wrestling coming to Calgary? It's crazy that you can reach people that easy now.
Yeah.
As we run out of time, before we get to those greatest five, Conor McGregor, is it a work? Is he really retired?
Well, this was crazy, man. I was just coming on the air today, and we saw his tweet saying, "You know, I've decided to retire young. Thanks for the cheese. Catch y'all later."
Throw some emojis in there.
And being a wrestling fan and you know someone that follows the fight game, the first thing that I said was like, "Okay, the chances of this being legit." Or, you know, he may intend it, but it actually lasting is like 2-3%.
Yeah.
Now, there is a little bit of an issue. I mean, he was at an MMA event in Ireland, as far as I know, about a week ago, just a bit more, where a young man died in the cage. And
how did he die?
He got punched in the head like 11 times.
It was one of Conor's teammates that was fighting the guy. And after, like, Conor's, you know, notoriously cocky he was very professional and humble about it. He said, "You know what? This is a big blow to all of us. One of our brothers died. This is a serious thing. This is a loss for everyone.
Be him an opponent or a teammate.
It's a brother. You know, he was very
we haven't heard anything about that. But Ariel Helwani, who's like a very respected MMA guy, I mean, about as connected as anyone, said, "Listen, this." You know, multiple sources say this is not a ruse, a troll job, or anything. There's some stuff behind it. Even his coach said. So I would be absolutely blown away because of how much money. It all comes down to this. And he is as marketable as anyone. But it's funny, if you noticed whom he had just recently followed on Twitter. Shane McMahon, Stephanie McMahon, Triple H.
But there's the other side of the coin too.
There's no one that could fit in better, that guy can work a mic.
So with the way he did it, did he give the warning?
No.
He just tweeted out. Dana White is freaking out right now.
That's what I mean, yeah.
Where is Dana White? That's what we all want to know.
Nate Diaz's tweet was bullshit where he puts, I retire too.
I know, that was bullshit.
But see, here's the other side of the coin, which you know gets my wrestler mind working. Right now, currently, all the MMA headlines are all about the USADA, are all about guys pissing hot. So basically, guys feeling good. And guys you would never expect. Pretty much everyone from Black House, you know, Machida, Anderson Silva, you know, you're hearing all this stuff about Dan Henderson, you know, Hector Lombard, whoever. All these guys, like, that's all you're hearing about is all these guys testing positive. You're hearing about the bullshit between John Jones and Daniel Cormier, one accusing the other one of
pulling out of the cops.
Yeah, Jones and the cops, Jones and cocaine. Cormier multiple times pulling out of the fight. Jones saying, "Hey, all these guys I talked to that know you, so you're not really fucking injured." Like, it's just, there's a lot of negativity on it that part of me is thinking, like, they're just trying to get people to focus on that fight.
It's getting, like, the 80s wrestlers.
Yeah, they're just trying to get people to focus on this fight and be jacked for it and kind of, take it away. No, I'll give it back. That whole thing, right? Like, it's almost using in-ring psychology and what they're doing. But he is married. So after the, you know, I'm sure his wife was well aware too of the guy dying in the ring. So that could be one of those things. You know, you're not just
Conor McGregor doesn't seem like a guy that's making a big decision because a woman's telling.
Yeah, he is Irish.
I suppose that is Irish. Fighter dying in, you know, on another continent in the sport, does that have any effect on it in North America? Do you think? Is there any?
No, it's happened before.
No, I mean, this is about as violent as a game.
Yeah, it's
happened. Would it happen, say, in Las Vegas?
It's happened in boxing before.
Yeah. It's never happened in the UFC.
It happened in hockey. I mean, a guy died from a hockey fight in Canada a few years
ago. Pretty recently.
But times have changed. But like, it's sensitive about concussions and head trauma and stuff like that. So
that whole business.
Is that going
to... Yeah, it's a time bomb waiting to happen. Right now, the business hasn't been evolved long enough for guys to be 15, 20 years removed from it and suffer all the CTE shit, right? Like, the business as a whole, yeah, sure, guys from those early days where there wasn't as much knockouts from the Hoist Gracie and Dan Severin days, they're getting a little older now, but they're, you know, like, from the really the boom which happened in, like, the, you know, 2004, 2005, basically right up until kind of when Lesnar came on the scene there, those guys are far from retiring, so, you know, fingers crossed.
Doing such crazy stuff. I mean, like, a couple of those, but what about just the wrestling? I mean, like, I think about that, we'll never forget The Rock versus Mick Foley. I think Mick was Mankind at the time. He was just getting hammered like 30 times in the head.
He was handcuffed.
Yeah.
I mean, it was the most mind-blowing thing, knowing what we know now.
I can't watch that.
And I'll give you, I mean, hey, it would be great to see some of those other moves, but, you know, as guys that are in the business, I mean, you have to be respectful of WWE trying to still maintain. How can you have a business that maintains itself for years if you're basically killing all your talent?
Exactly.
You got to change the
What I mean. Like, WWE has taken such a hit over the years, like in the media and with sponsors, due to wrestlers being hurt like that. So it's going to happen eventually where you're going to see UFC fighters turning into vegetables from getting their head kicked in.
I think, you know, because UFC was a newer sport and they've kind of learned that maybe earlier in their infancy, not to mention how much scrutiny they were under because, let's face it, they only got legalized in New York recently.
Even Ontario was pretty recent.
But the way everyone's so sensitive now, say that fighter died in California or New York.
This happened.
With the presence they have now, though, those states going, yeah, maybe we shouldn't do this, like with the media backlash.
Ultimately, it's the referee is in there for the fighter's safety to stop it if it's getting to the point where a guy can't defend himself. I didn't see the fight personally. I've heard lots of guys shit on referees for early stoppages. I never will. Like, that's his fucking job, man. Like, he's there to protect these guys from themselves, really, because these guys that have been trained for a fight, if they can still stand, they'll say, no, keep it going. I'll never shit on a ref for stopping a fight early. I'll shit on a ref for stopping a fight late. There was one who was a Mark Hunt and Stipe Miocic, I think, a little while back, where Miocic was just bludgeoning him for round after round after round, and it was on another continent. I think it might have been in Japan, it wasn't one of the regular UFC referees. It was someone locally that they had put in there, because the referees aren't hired by the UFC. They're hired by the state athletic commissions.
Lombard and Magny, right?
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah, exactly.
Whatever,
yeah.
Last month?
Yeah, just a month ago. And it's just like, and now Lombard's fighting again already against Dan Henderson, that's all those two guys are going to do is throw bombs. But that's a fight where, like, that referee has affected Mark Hunt's career by letting him absorb something like 300 significant punches or some ridiculous fucking thing in that fight where it's just like, are you fucking kidding me, man? Stop the fucking fight. The guy's a zombie. He's a punching bag.
A huge responsibility on the refs. I mean, it particularly in something like MMA that, you know, you need to have quality. And, you know, sometimes the fans don't like the early stoppage, but you know what?
Those people's lives you're talking about.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Even in wrestling, like, we talked about this on a podcast a few weeks ago. There was that match on the NXT pay-per-view where the guy got cut under the eye and he kept bleeding and they kept stopping
him to
clean it up. And I've talked to several wrestlers who are of the opinion that it's my body, I should be able to do what I want with it. And same thing too, like a few years ago, they just had a documentary where Daniel Bryan was talking about how pissed off he was because Triple H once called off one of his matches because he was hurt. And he went backstage, he was kicking things and throwing things. He's like, of all people, Triple H telling me he tore his quad and kept going. And Triple H just kind of explained to him that it's like,
I'm protecting you from yourself.
Yeah.
The head's a different ballgame.
It's a different ballgame. You can tie it to anything where it's like, sometimes as athletes, we need somebody to rein us in. Because when the adrenaline's going and we're in the middle of a fight or a performance or a game or what have you, you know,
Somebody
see it nightly in the NHL playoffs. Sure. You don't have time to be thinking about your long-term health.
Before we sign off with Hustler here, what are the greatest five sports events you've attended in your career?
Holy smokes, dude. That is...
This, of course, is for greatest5.com, the official sponsor of the CWE webcast.
The greatest five. And this might not be full. I've been lucky enough, I mean, through my work, I've been at the last six Super Bowls.
Oh, wow.
So, I mean, every time we go there, that is just an event that is unlike any other. Probably the Giants-Patriots back in Indianapolis.
Oh, yeah. Like that one, the last Hail Mary.
That one was great. The first one I ever went to in Cowboy Stadium where WrestleMania was with the Packers-Steelers. Was something else. As a Royal, as a Casey, a long-suffering Casey Royals fan, see, I've got my world championship thing. I was actually at Game 6 and 7 of the World Series the year before when the Royals actually lost to the Giants. I was there for Game 6 when they won. There for Game 7 when they lost. Despite losing, just, I mean, having, you know, being a fan of a team for a long time that hadn't done anything in 30 years and being in a city that's sort of like a second home for me, very similar to Winnipeg, it would be like if the Jets got to the Stanley Cup. So that was something that I will, you know, never forget in my life. Went to, and this isn't as much a game, but I went to the PGA Championship in Tulsa, Oklahoma, back at the height of Tiger Woods. And to be able to see that, that was truly something. And, you know, being a Winnipeg guy, I got to put in two Jet moments from the old days. Dave Ellett's double overtime goal against the Oilers to put us up 3-1 in the playoffs.
And then lose.
But at the moment,
that was
on a high forever. And I think I would have to say the return of the Jets to Winnipeg. And that was something that, you know, so close to any of us that have been there. Yep. Lucky enough to be in the building that night. And while the game itself, we lost. And, you know, I think of the first exhibition game when Buff blew that guy up.
Yeah.
20 seconds. I watch that on YouTube at least 50 times a year. Check it out. First Jets shift, Bufflin and Stu. But that would be, I'd say for sporting events, I mean, there's some others, but that would be top of my head. Those are my five.
And to sign us off with some wrestling, in your opinion, the greatest five wrestlers of all time.
Greatest five wrestlers of all time? Well, you know what? I mean, from my perspective, I put in the personalities as well.
Some of my favorites are,
I mean, my favorite of all time, Bobby the Brain Heenan.
Great choice.
And Bobby, and I still think of the fact where his line, and I've used this on a couple of my buddies every now and then after a late night somewhere, I'm like, you're the sort of guy where you go into a restaurant, you don't even need a bill. I see you had the eggs, the bacon, the gravy. You know? I mean, just an absolute, absolute classic. From a kid, my favorite wrestler was the Junkyard Dog. JYD, as a, you know, I just loved his, you know, what he did. He's probably not one. I'm probably a poor judge of the greatest wrestlers of all time.
Personal judge.
Stone Cold still is like the icon of it, and even with him not actually wrestling, I love the mic work more than anything. And that's why I'm a huge fan of Chris Jericho as well. From, you know, and particularly, I mean, I was just watching, they had the Monday Night War, but he was doing in WCW, and then his, you know, coming on the scene in WWE. I mean, I thought that was so cool. And I got to put Mick Foley. Like, honestly, he is as talented. Like, he doesn't have the look, which probably made him have to overcome more, do more than everyone else. As well. Just the fact that he is as lucid as he is right now, and funny, and seemingly healthy. I thank God he got up when he did, but what a talent, you know, creatively, the fact that he could go from being this psycho Mankind going off the cell to then being, you know, the most lovable guy, and, you know, I mean, The Rock obviously in there too, Rock and Sock, that tag team era, I mean, and that was some of my favorite stuff, because I really do love, I love great matches, don't get me wrong, and I have huge respect for what they're doing, but just from an entertainment standpoint, I love it when you guys don't have to kill each other. So that's the five of you guys.
How can everyone listen to you every day, and where can they find you on social media?
Well, every day in the Peg on TSN 1290. The warm-up's 2 to 3. That's where often we'll do wrestling stuff. If Danny's got a guy in town, we'll try and squeeze in a segment there. Hustle and Lawless goes 3 to 6. A little more newsy. Gary Lawless from TSN joins me every day. I'm active on not as much Facebook, but definitely Twitter and Instagram. It's Hustlerama. Hustler, like the magazine, AMA. You can find me there.
Is your guys' broadcast put up anywhere that our listeners outside of Winnipeg can listen to?
Absolutely. I mean, you can go onto tsn.ca every day and just listen live. If you go to tsn1290.ca, there will be the Hustler and Lawless and the warm-up podcasts. You can check the show pretty much every day. Thanks so much for having me, guys. This is
a lot of fun.
Thank you very much for joining us. We'll have to get you back on the program, and we'll let you get down to Santa Lucia so you can start pounding back those doubles and enjoy your Tuesday night.
doubles. No diesel. Third period of the game. You guys, all the best, and good luck on Friday. Say happy birthday to Bobby Jane.
You got it. We'll be right back.
wrestler,
yeah.
the same way you become anything else. You have to go to school and work really, really, really hard.
Instead, tears stream down his face.
I've never had a second to be more careful of them. Okay?
Sounds like that, yeah. Yes!
I am a personal trainer, so I help people get in shape and the gym.
Wrap up the program. We're actually running on time and we're not making you spend the majority of your life listening to us on a weekly basis. We're cutting it down after a long 2-hour podcast with Spider last week, but a great podcast.
Oh, fuck, man.
I'll make the announcement now. It'll probably be announced just around the time this goes up. We're going to do part two with Spider next Tuesday, but he's going to be joined by Darren the Bomb Dalton, his OTC tagging partner and longtime best friend.
Killer.
So we're going to get the two of them in the room together. We're going to talk about who they've beaten up together as a team. I think I'm going
to
ask him.
We might need like a list kind of like credits to roll up the screen with just all the names and what they beat.
I think we're going to have to put him on the spot and ask him who would win in a fight if they fought each other.
Oh, geez. Oh man. I think they'd call it like the Rocky Apollo Creed double.
There was one time that the first time we had Dalton on the podcast, Travis was afraid to be on the podcast. I told Dalton, I was like, he's a little uncomfortable because you've got a reputation. And Dalton called Travis out on it, actually in that room over there, and Travis almost cried.
That is all a lie.
He's like, why does Darren want to talk to me? I was like, well, I told him what's up, and Travis almost had tears in his eyes. Trembling, kind of like when he was having sex with that girl. He's like so scared.
It's really cute that you say that, considering number one, I was busy doing something else that night. Number two, I talked to Dalton about that because he did ask me, and he actually got hot at you and had a big long conversation with you in that room.
Because you lied to him.
Oh, did I now?
That's why.
Did I now?
You didn't want to be on the podcast with him because.
You want to have this conversation next week with him here?
We sure can. Right. I'll talk about anything. So,
try to stooge me off and just completely make up lies?
I'm not making up lies.
It's a complete lie.
You said you were afraid to. You didn't say you were afraid. You didn't want to be associated with the reputation he had, and that's what the heat was from.
What reputation?
Just him being a scary man.
I've met Dalton a million times.
And you're always scared of him.
You're so full of it.
Back to the topics at hand. Speaking of gangs, the Bullet Club are making their waves on WWE TV. They introduced them with AJ Styles last night with some segments.
Yeah.
Is this going to stick? Is it a swerve?
Not forever, obviously, but this is what people wanted to see. So they're gonna use it to their advantage. If for whatever reason, if it doesn't take off, they'll disband it pretty quick. But I think it will. I think it's going to be hot. I think it's going to be talked about. I think it's going to be one of those things obviously we're well past the days of the must-watch TV that we were talking about earlier. But it's going to be the closest damn thing you can get to it where people are like, fucking rights, this is the damn Bullet Club here we're talking about. And I think it's just a matter of time before they put Finn Balor into that fold as well, just to really, they'll milk it a bit, and then they'll get him in there, and they'll make it a faction similar to Evolution or to, whoever else they've kind of had. They won't go too cutesy with it. I don't think they're going to bring in Chase or anything, but they won't make it this big huge.
Every faction needs its virtual.
Yeah, they won't make it this big huge. 12 guys as part of the faction where, with the NWO, we had Stevie Ray and Horace Hogan in there.
I'd really appreciate if Stevie Ray was part of the Bullet Club. I'd watch it.
Well, I think he's fucked up. I think he doesn't work wrestling.
No, he still does. I mean, he does appearances for Booker T's company. In closing, I want to kind of touch back on, we're talking about the ratings being low.
Yeah.
And they're kind of doing this whole gimmick that Shane McMahon's in charge and he's leading change. And essentially, they're kind of ushering in, like, the wrestling era of, you know, guys like AJ Styles, Sami Zayn, Kevin Owens, Cesaro being on top.
Yeah.
Now, the ratings are at an all-time low. How long is it before that gets pegged as the reason?
Correlation.
And like, okay, well, we're trying to push small guys that are wrestling and it's not working, and they pull the plug and go back to...
They'll stay with it for a bit.
You think they'll give it a fair chance?
Yeah.
So it's always kind of been what's happened before. They always have like a scapegoat. Like, oh, well, we tried this, it didn't work, and then they'll cut it and... go back to, you know, then we'll go back to John Cena and Randy Orton.
Yeah,
and
made a but as you said with Road Dogg, like what you said, he said to you was the business is at an all-time high. They care about stock and what money they're making. I think they don't put the same kind of stock that anybody else does in the ratings.
I think
the only reason that the dirt sheets still talk about ratings is because it was such a big deal back in the day. So fans will still click on articles. It's all about, for those dirt sheets, it's all about clicking on the articles, and fans still will click and read about ratings.
And
until
that
stops... that we talked about.
And that isn't always the thing. Like,
do you think Vince doesn't care, though?
It depends. It depends.
Deep down,
I think it's, yeah,
why aren't they watching?
Yeah. Well, I think it's you know, case-by-case scenario. Mm. And one of the when this kind of stuff comes up, one of the biggest things, you know, that I like to point out on, like, is Bret Hart. Bret Hart got pushed from, you know, early 90s on, but no matter where he went, they were kind of, with that company that has Bret Hart was always losing the war. It was. It fucking was, man. Like, you know, like the early to mid 90s, WWE had when they put him on top, that's when they took their lowest fucking dip. They didn't, but they never attributed that to him. They just attributed to, you know, the product as a whole and whatever else.
Technically,
and then,
if you ask Bret, it was Diesel. It was when he lost the Diesel.
Right.
Yeah,
it was in 93 and 94, you know, like, come on.
Yeah.
You know, he lost the title in 95 to him. But then and WCW really was, you know, running away with things, winning the ratings wars. And then in late 97, Bret Hart jumped over and really didn't start getting on TV until 98. Then all of a sudden, WWE's back on fucking top. And I know correlation doesn't prove cause. And that's what I'm trying to get across. I think everybody kind of knows that. I think they've got enough people on their team to say, hey, man, just because there's a correlation doesn't mean that that's the cause, right? Like, there's a million parallels in real life that you can draw. You know, you can't say, like, oh, the reason why, you know, those terrorists attacked those your French friends there in Paris was because they didn't like this particular band. It's like, nah, it just so happened to be that Eagles of Metal band was playing that night, and that's where they popped in.
But just from listening to years of interviews and stories and people talking about what Vince likes and doesn't like, he's never really been big on that style of wrestling or that size of wrestler. So as much as he likes making his money, you know, is he sitting there going, like, this isn't what I envisioned my company being? Or is he embracing change and allowing something different? Is he allowing, you know, say a Triple H show, you know, this is the wave of the future, this is the direction we should try?
I think so.
Or is it like, I'll try it, but I'd really like to see...
But what, it wasn't working
Braun Strowman wrestling Randy Orton in that main event,
yeah,
not AJ Styles.
Remember, it's a 3-hour show. Is Braun Strowman going to wrestle Randy Orton for 30 minutes?
But it wasn't working for him before. Like, look at from... really 2002 to 2012, right. You know, he'd bring in these guys and they develop themselves and be it over.
Like, I completely agree. Like, don't get me wrong. I like what's happening
and that
now,
fucking formula, like, of the guys with $1 million body and 10-cent work rates was not fucking working for them, man. Like, you know, it just wasn't. And I think he's well aware of that, and I think he's well aware of, we can't just go back to what we were doing that didn't work, so...
But you kind of hit an interesting point, though, when you talk about, like, Bret and the business being down, like, that was part of the reason, if you know, listen to the interviews as well, like, business was down when Eddie Guerrero was champion, and he was a smaller wrestling champion, you know, Rey Mysterio,
yeah.
You know, guys like that, so there is kind of a trend and kind of, like, stereotype that when a smaller wrestler's on top,
mm-hmm.
the numbers... tend to dip. That's the whole myth in urban legend. So,
but when Michaels was on top, things kind of really picked up.
All of those,
is he though?
All of
from
those
where it was two, you know, years ago.
Because Michaels was gone around 97. He kind of
was
gone.
Right, yeah, you're
he
right.
He left
yeah.
in March
yeah,
98.
Yeah, his run kind of coincided with Brett's, I guess. You're right. Yeah.
Yeah. So
yeah,
look at the history books.
The business is already down at those times, though. Like when Eddie was champion. In 2004, the business, like we were talking about earlier, business started to go down in 2002 and 2003, not 2004. So it was already trending downward. Same thing with when Bret Hart was champion. it was trending, you know, guys were leaving, so they went a different direction, but the business is already trending down.
But those guys never brought it back up, though, so they kind of get stuck with that label, unfortunately.
Yeah, and that may be fair. I'm just saying that maybe if they'd gone to continue the direction, the business is already down, so I don't think it's fair to say that that they were what made the business go down. They just didn't make it go back up again.
That's what I mean. So how long until they go, okay, well, this experiment's not working, let's go back to what we think works.
I'd rather
watch Eddie Guerrero over Diesel any day of the week, but if Vince could find a guy like Diesel that he can put in the main event, he's more likely to put him in the main event over Eddie Guerrero.
But Diesel didn't make the ratings go up. They tried that, right?
I know, but that's the formula. That's my argument. Yeah. If that's always their go-to, okay, the numbers aren't up, let's put the big guy on top.
Yeah, you know what
let's
they
put
did?
John Cena. Let's put Randy Orton.
Yeah, but what did they do? They gave it to Diesel, and then they gave it right back to Bret Hart when it wasn't working. Right, so you could argue that they tried it and then it didn't work, and so they went right back to what it was.
It was kind of a transition though to Sid and like Taker and that whole time thing though.
Yeah.
Like I personally, I'd watch a whole show of Eddie Guerrero and Bret Hart and Shawn Michaels. Me personally, but looking at history and the way they've dictated it and kind of the general consensus.
And don't get me wrong, like
if Vince had 30 Diesels. There'd probably be 30 Diesels on TV.
Yeah, don't get me wrong. It's I don't think that the business should be all Eddie Guerrero's or what have you. Like it's variety. There should be a little bit of everything.
Even in Travis Cole.
What's that? I think there's a place for a Travis Cole.
Not if you ask in Jordan Garber. Places. There's not.
Don't spoil it for people who haven't watched it yet. Yeah, I think there's it's variety and whatnot, but if you really think about it, how many guys in the business over the last 50 years actually move the needle? Those are your Mount Rushmore guys. Those are your John Cena's, your Rock's, your Stone Cold, your Hulk Hogan. You could even argue, we were just talking about it, like most guys, like if you talked about some of the all-time greats, Shawn Michaels would be on it, but you just said that the business wasn't necessarily way up when Shawn Michaels was champion. So how many guys really, really moved that needle? I don't think you can attribute that needle moving to just one guy.
Well, I think right now too, they have a bit of grasp on things like who's selling more merch, you know, like so they'll see if they're if they're doing this and the business kind of, you know, their ratings are down, but they're selling hundreds upon thousands of Baylor Club shirts or whatever the fuck they're gonna call the faction. They're gonna keep them running.
Yeah,
you know, like plain and simple.
And further to that, like Roman Reigns is a lot more Rock or Stone Cold than he is Bret Hart or Shawn Michaels. No disrespect to him at all. I'm sure he would say the same thing. And that's not even me talking about his work. Just the kind of champion he is and the kind of style he has is more.
Now that you mention it, I think that's kind of what hurts him. Is he's kind of in between. Like he's a good worker.
Yeah, of course.
But he's a good worker. So he's like he's got that wrestling aspect, but he's not Kurt Angle or Eddie Guerrero or Chris Benoit. And he's got a great look, and he's got a good character, but he's not The Rock or Stone Cold. He's kind of stuck in limbo. He's got a little bit of everything, but he doesn't have like that definitive like this is what makes him him.
He's the brand.
There's the guys that are the wrestling guys, and then the promo guys, and it's like, and that doesn't mean that. Just because you're a promo guy, you're not a great wrestler. Like Stone Cold Steve Austin was a phenomenal wrestler, but when people think of him, they think of his personality and his and stuff like that. And then when people think of Shawn Michaels, it doesn't mean he's a bad promo, but it's like he's Mr. WrestleMania. He's a you know what I mean.
You know what,
and like you said, so Roman Reigns is kind of in between there right now.
I think what really caused that early '90s dip that wrestling took all throughout the mid '90s. Like whose absence I would really attribute that to. Nails. That's when Nails left.
That's true.
Yeah. Kevin Cannon, I do not know if you've heard about this, but I was in a locker room on Saturday night, and there was a guy who had a suit very similar to Nails.
Was it Sidney Manson?
No. His gimmick is that he's a caddy, kind of like Dolph Ziggler. So he's got like the caddy costume, but behind, and it was white. It was all white, but from behind, it looked like a white version of Nails' jumpsuit.
Oh.
So I was like, oh, what the hell is this? And then I asked him, and he had no idea who Nails was. So I'm like losing my mind, and the next guy that walks in the room, I'm like, please tell me you know who Nails is. And he's like, kind of sounds familiar. And I'm like, are you freaking kidding me, guys? Like, you're killing me.
I think you're really onto something here, because Nails was a part of that huge drawing Wembley Stadium show against Virgil. Huge match.
That's
about as big as it gets. Shortly after, chokes out Vince McMahon.
Didn't he fuck Gerald Briscoe or something like that?
What?
I think so.
I don't know.
I don't know.
Or fucked him.
No, like fucking. I think.
Like assaulted him?
No. I think
sexually assaulted.
Or no, I think Briscoe tried to sexually assault him, or one of what something like that. Like one of them propositioned either Briscoe or Paterson, and one of the two propositioned him with a push, like, "Hey, we'll give you a push if you suck my dick," or something, something to that effect. I don't know if that was the exact terms of it. I think that was nailed.
I remember listening to Warrior interviews where he would talk about that, about those guys.
Yeah, I think that happened to Nails. I think that they said, "Hey, you want a push? Suck my dick." Like, it wasn't like that blunt. Maybe
right.
It was a little more kind of in a roundabout way.
So
but
you're saying that's what Nails claimed.
So kind of what Travis offers promoters, but the opposite. They
yes.
were offering him.
Yeah. They're saying, "Hey, you want that?" Because apparently, or allegedly, the plan before, you know, he fucking choked out Vince was to put Nails into a program with The Undertaker, so...
Yeah, it was supposed to lead to a coffin match.
Yeah, so for them to kind of already have that book, maybe he already did suck someone's dick. You know, like to,
Jesus.
And then who did that spot go to? Kamala, I think, instead? So Kamala probably sucked
I really, I think if you analyze it, Nails, Virgil, two of wrestling's biggest icons.
Yeah.
What was it, like 70, 80,000 people, Wembley Stadium?
No, it was a fucking ridiculous amount, yeah.
They didn't over 100.
I think
it was, I think it was like 80,000.
Yeah,
or
it was something
like
that.
Biggest house at that point since WrestleMania 3 in 1987.
Mm-hmm.
Nails leaves that night. The business did not draw a house that big again until a couple Sundays ago.
Cowboy Stadium.
So it shows the
damage that was
it did to the business.
And just shortly before that, that's when Nails resurfaced at a convention when he hadn't been seen anywhere in years, and Nails made his first convention appearance maybe a month before Mania. No, I'm fucking...
Wow, it makes sense to me.
Nails, I think we need to book Nails.
Nails leaving the business was the nail in the coffin of professional wrestling for almost 25 years.
Yeah.
Wow, I feel like a Mythbuster right
now. Yeah,
Discovered like some secret holy grail.
Yeah, we're like Tom Hanks in the Bible Code movie there. You know?
Yeah, I think we need to do a whole other podcast just talking our theory on Nails'
effect
on the business.
Yeah.
Well, there's nothing we can say to top that. That's groundbreaking, really. We've just discovered something about the business. Maybe nobody but Vince McMahon deep down knows.
I think so.
On why the business took so long to get to record highs again. You know, you kind of saw it with Stone Cold Steve Austin, but Steve Austin didn't draw the house Nails did at Wembley Stadium, so...
Never.
Wow. Well, we're going to be back next week with Spider and Darren Dalton, and those are some guys with some similar traits to Nails, so we'll definitely talk to them about Nails and maybe run this theory by them and see what they think.
Sounds like a plan.
We'll see you next week.